Okay, so welcome back. I apologise to everyone for the hiatus we've just been through in terms of a suspension of our committee. We'll go back to the line of questioning, and I'm turning to Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Convener. I wanted to ask about rurality and poverty and whether or not those living and learning in rural communities were well served during the pandemic. There's lots of cases where people struggled to access digital learning, where lots of, even in my own in my own constituency, what are relatively more urban areas, there was lots of community support out there. People, lots of people working together, but there are lots of people who live in very remote communities where they struggle to access that kind of community support. And it's just whether that's something you've picked up on at all.
So yeah, I mean, there's I'm just trying to think back to work we did do in terms of the response from children and young people and families in rural communities. There are additional barriers pre-existing the pandemic and clearly exacerbated or reinforced by the pandemic, particularly around transport issues and being able to access both school opportunities but out of school opportunities as well. Issues around if you're growing up in a family in a very low income in a rural area, you may be one of a few, and it's maybe there's less you're less part of a kind of a community. There's more issues in terms of making sure that that's not stigmatised or that there's no that the schools and education handles that in a way that mitigates any risk of stigma, so ensuring that support. So, I'm racking my brains. We have actually done a bit of work, and I can share a bit more in terms of some of the specific cost barriers that young people experienced in rural areas. But I'd need to go back actually and come back to you maybe with more of that.
Cool.
On a kind of aligned area that I'd like to get to at some point around mental health and wellbeing. We just published earlier this year an investigation by children in the Western Isles into mental health and wellbeing. So clearly speaking from their perspective and in island communities. And that's been presented to local authority and NHS in the Western Isles. So that's on our website, and there's links to that in what we've submitted. So those children gave a very kind of clear insight into their experiences in the last 12 to 18 months and also what they would like from education system and other providers in their communities.
No, thank you. I guess the reason why I asked is yesterday we saw a kind of shift in focus away from the Scottish Index of multiple deprivation to low-income families. And I've kind of long lobbied the government and asked about what was happening about hidden rural poverty. But I didn't at any point think that support would come at the expense of our most deprived communities, because I think quite clearly where there's a concentration of poverty, that presents certain challenges. And as you've identified, in rural communities where you're in isolated poverty, you can have very different challenges, and both kind of need to be met. Do you think that looking at low-income families is the right measure for how funding's allocated, or do you think we still need the index of multiple deprivation in a sort of? Because I've always thought a hybrid system was going to meet both those challenges.
So I mean, I think we need to look at both. So I think in terms of overall funding and ensuring that we're providing support and ensuring that the resources are available to tackle poverty wherever it is in Scotland, using family low income data as a way of doing that, I think makes sense. As we sort of discussed earlier, I think there is also other place-based barriers that need to be as part of wider tackling poverty, tackling disadvantage policies need to be addressed as well. There are particular issues faced by families in rural areas, higher energy costs in many cases, higher transport costs, not having access in your local community in a different kind of way maybe than some of the most disadvantaged areas, but still having barriers to access out-of-school learning opportunities that don't exist elsewhere. So there is, it shouldn't be an either or. We need to be ensuring that overall funding settlements are adequate so that wherever you go to school, whether it's in a school in an area of multiple deprivation or if it's a school in
to push a little bit, do you think it's wrong to move away from the Scottish Index of Multiple Deprivation when it comes to allocating the attainment funding? Do you think that was a mistake?
No, I think overall, using low-income data
is the better model.
It's a better model, but that shouldn't be, obviously we need to make sure that resources aren't, that we're adequately funding schools everywhere to respond to the needs in their areas.
So, I guess.
And that's part of a wider funding settlement in terms of how we fund our schools and education system.
Thank you. Just very quickly, I wanted to come back on your last point and reinforce some of what John said about it needs to be a place and people approach that we take. And so looking at those on the lowest incomes or on low incomes across Scotland, I do think will mean that we may be able to look to see how we can take more of an intersectional approach, which recognises the way different inequalities and how they impact on you and your family may mean that what you're experiencing as a result of poverty could be different. And we can look at how we respond accordingly to support single parents, people from Black and minority ethnic communities, those with a disability in the family, etc., and a combination thereof. I think in terms of the rurality question, what we saw was some of the issues John's spoken about around transport, the availability of support, the logistics of getting support. And one of the things that we heard across the board from single parents, but in some ways a bit more intensified from those in more rural areas, was that feeling of isolation. Increased isolation, not even necessarily living physically close enough to anyone to be able to see other people and stuff like that, and how did that intensify the experience? And I think that's some of what we need to be looking at in terms of how we respond to the sort of multi-layered nature of poverty and inequality that's being experienced by children and young people on low incomes.
Thank you. That's really helpful. That's me done, Convener.
Thank you, Oliver. Co-Cap Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. Thank you for emphasising the need for a holistic approach in tackling poverty. Over 30 years as a teacher, I've taught in many demographics and lots of areas of multiple deprivation. So a lot of what you're saying has resonated with me, and seeing the whole child and the family. So I just wanted to put that on record for that. So over the years, but also more recently with COVID, do you think that there has been a change in culture in education with regard to having a greater awareness of the impacts of deprivation? And as we recover, how can we make sure that learners and families are at the heart of that recovery, rather than us just talking about systems and the focus is on the people and rather than the actual mechanistic side of things? So I'd like to hear from Colin first, and then from Satwit, and then John, please.
This might seem a bit strange in terms of the focus this committee has, but I think the focus on attainment is the wrong focus. I think the focus needs to be on the experience of the pandemic, how that's been experienced by families with least resource, least access to all the supports that might have been available, families who were cut off from many services that they relied on until those services found a more kind of creative, different way of working. For me, the focus was during the pandemic on well-being and on mental health. That's what schools have been told us was their main focus. They realised every good teacher, if I can call them that, every good teacher that we knew and we engaged with professionally was focused on some very basic things like maintaining the connection, checking in with children, asking them how they were, providing them some fun or structure to the day, however limited, making sure that their mums or dads or grands, whoever they lived with, had the basics that they needed, checking in that there was food in the house. These are the kind of things that teachers were doing, many teachers were doing during the pandemic. They invested all that time in those relationships and well-being. I'm sorry if I'm going a bit off script in your question, but now find themselves back in school with this intense pressure on what we call attainment. We had a very kind of visceral reaction to something just recently in a school that we're working in. I won't name them because that wouldn't be fair. But we've been working with children and staff, and we've been asking children about their current experiences and current views of their educational experience. And one of the things that came back very clearly was children saying, teachers aren't very interested in me out with school in my life. When we reported this back, there were tears among some teachers. They were very moved by that and quite hurt, really, you know, I think. And they were saying, you know, we've spent 18 months being so clear about how we love these children and doing all these things, and now we're back in school, the children are feeling like we care less. So what they've done is, amazingly quickly, they've turned it around. Every child is on a soft start. The whole school, you know, is on a soft start. There's much more emotional well-being check-ins. They realise that this pressure they felt, whether internally or coming from somewhere, who knows where, that the focus now has to be on literacy and numeracy, because there's been, in inverted commas, lost learning, that, you know, we need to park that, because what we're doing is we're going to lose all the ground that we built in terms of maintaining relationships, especially with the most vulnerable children. So sure, we want our children to do well in terms of literacy and numeracy. This isn't a primary school. But unless we maintain those relationships and continue to look after the children, we're just chasing our tails in some way. We're not going to make that up. And on the other hand, we also know from last year, we had children up to the age of 14 reporting in our surveys that they, more than 50% were anxious about exams. These are children under 14. And that grew during the pandemic. So what we have is an education, a system that's perceived to be about attainment, about exams, when in fact its focus, if we're going to have any kind of sense of what we call recovery, needs to be on mental health and well-being. And it feels like we're losing ground. It feels like we're layering more pressure on teachers and learning support assistants, and losing any kind of sense of what we might have gained through relationships. I think we said in our submission, recovery is not going to be on a spreadsheet with exam results. It's such a loss of purpose and a misdirection. We feel quite strongly about it because we're seeing it in schools when we're there day to day at the moment.
So where do you think that pressure is coming from then, for, you know, that focus on attainment that you were talking about? Where is that coming from?
Well, at one end of the system, it's coming because we have an exam diet that's been announced will happen this year. So, you know, in terms of secondary schools, the focus is now on, my goodness, we're going to have a full set of exams as they were pre-pandemic. So we are now working towards that, knowing that a number of children disengaged or found it difficult to learn. In the primary school, we have testing, we have a cultural language, a norm around children doing well and making up for what's been lost. We don't have for me, education leaders yourselves should be leading a discussion that is a cultural shift that says we are most interested in the well-being of our children. And so for the next few years, that is going to be our priority, because we've got all this evidence that says that well-being has been undermined. Now, I don't know about you, but in my broader family life, in my workplace, I see the impact of this. In our professional lives, we're seeing it all the time. In this building, you must see the impact of mental health issues, anxiety, depression. You know, these things are very real, and they're real in our children. So we can chase this thing called attainment. We can think that we can get children back to whatever normal was, but I just think it's such a lost opportunity. It's a mistake. I'm sorry, I think I've probably gone way off what your question was.
That's, that's all right. It was interesting to hear what you had to say on that. Can I go to Satwa, please? My question originally was about the a cultural change in education and a greater awareness of the impacts of deprivation and putting families and children at the heart rather than systems.
I think it goes back to something that you mentioned just before you asked a question about the holistic approach and the greater awareness of needing to work with the whole person and not a particular aspect of the person. We certainly saw in our experience during the lockdowns that there were some schools, some head teachers, some staff groups who absolutely got that. You know, we administered grants for energy costs for single parent families, etc. And there was one particular school, but it was the head who spent the whole day doing applications to make sure families got the money that they needed. They knew that was the priority for their families, supporting their well-being, supporting them with the material costs, the additional material costs that they found themselves experiencing. And I think I really want to echo what Colin has said. What we need to do is be focusing on creating the conditions for children and young people to thrive. You know, we know children learn best when they are secure, stable, you know, not anxious about anything, not worrying about whether there's going to be enough food in the house for them or what their mum or dad is coping with. A lot of what we saw were anxieties that the children also had for their parents and how their parents were coping during this and what it meant for them. And there were some families who are still having to live under tighter restrictions due to health conditions and things like that. You know, we've not all gone back to the way it was. And I think it's right that we take some time to think about, do we need to go back to the way things were? We had some families reporting that actually really took the tension out of some of their relationships, not having constant battles about getting ready, getting to school, doing your homework, etc., and stuff like that, and being able to have more of a flow and a rhythm to the day which suited where their children and young people were at. So I do think it is an opportunity to pause, to think about, to listen to what children, young people and families are saying is important to them. Mm-hmm. And using that as the starting point of how we begin to focus on recovery post-pandemic. I think it's right. There's lots of anxieties around educational qualifications, exams, etc., that we're seeing. And, you know, one of the things that families told us was, don't expect us to be able to start off from where we left off pre-pandemic. The impact this has had on mental health and well-being means that we need to start way back. You know, we need to get ourselves back to where we were pre-pandemic. So I do think it's critical and crucial that we look to see how we can support families through schools and what that nature of that support needs to be in a broader sense than just thinking, oh, they seem to be lagging behind on X, Y, and Z. Let's see how we can intensify teaching and learning to get them there. Actually, that's not going to work unless they're there ready to learn and thrive.
Yeah, that phrase of readiness to learn is one within the profession that, you know, I remember talking about quite a lot. I'm just going to move it on a little bit. John, I didn't want to take away your opportunity, but I'm conscious of time as well. I'm thinking of interventions that can help the situation. And, you know, somehow we always need to measure it, don't we? We need to have that proof as well, I suppose, on outcomes. I'm thinking of things like clothing grants, free school meals, but also universal credit cuts and benefit caps, which are mentioned in, you know, written submissions. So can you give me some examples of sort of interventions that have made a positive or a negative impact on children and families?
Yes, so in terms of positive impact, some of the interventions that were made over the last couple of years the replacement of free school meals, particularly when that was cash replacement. You know, children and parents reported back to us what a difference that additional resource made to them. The introduction of the hardship grants and now the bridging payments, taking to bridge the gap to the full rollout of Scottish Child Payment, the introduction of Scottish Child Payment, all that additional cash support into families makes a difference and is really important, and they report that back to us. In terms of school level interventions, as I sort of mentioned earlier, the evaluation of cost of school day would suggest that at school level they certainly see a difference in outcome in terms of participation and engagement. I don't think we're at the stage yet where we're able to say, and this is able to, you know, these interventions have impacted on directly on the attainment gap as yet. But I think the, whether it's school-based interventions or wider interventions to improve family incomes and boost the incomes of our lowest income families, they're clearly part of a process that will improve family resources and reduce the costs that children face at school. And I think the widely understood kind of the theory of change behind that will impact on participation at school, engagement at school, young people feeling enjoying the school environment, and all of which are absolutely critical for improving children's overall experience at school and their attainment, their achievement, their sense of what they get out of being at school.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. And to Bob Dorris.
Thank you, Convener. Really interesting line of questioning. I think I'd like to focus on the potential role of pupil equity funding going forward. I won't look at the level of funds. I would like to look at how, because that might come up during the budget process anyway, but how the funds could be spent. We've heard evidence this morning that schools pretty much know their children and families better than I've ever known them, because that was unavoidable truth as they sought to help them during lockdown. I would like to know about the opportunities going forward in relation to how schools could use funds over now a four-year period. They can plan strategically in theory over a four-year period, not in a silo in isolation, but is there opportunities for pupil equity funding to be used within the wider community to support the learning needs of children and the wider needs of families more generally, to make them ready to learn when they get to school? So any thoughts about how maybe you've saw equity funding used well in the past, perhaps during COVID, to help young people and their families, and what the opportunities may be going forward? That would be quite helpful to get on the record this morning. Sorry, I haven't said who should come in. Yes.
As far as I understand it, there is good evidence. It might not be easy to find on the National Improvement Hub, published by Education Scotland, but there is evidence that was a lot of evidence pre-pandemic about how PEF money was being used and about what is an effective intervention in terms of attainment. So there is that evidence there. What I don't know is how that evidence has been used, read, understood by regional improvement collaboratives or by school clusters or by schools. I suspect that many teachers don't have a lot of time to find and read evidence, but there is evidence there pre-pandemic as to what an effective intervention is. So there's that. There's certainly some great stuff I remember reading, written by educational psychologists, about initiatives that they knew that were effective in terms of individual learning. And then we also have a lot of the work that's come out of the improvement methodology. So there's kind of small scale things that people have scaled up. So there is lots of evidence, but that's pre-pandemic. Now, what I would suggest is that whilst we need to look at that evidence, we also need to be rethinking what we're using our PEF money for, because priorities for me have changed. The priority shouldn't be a kind of purest view of attainment and what an attainment gap is, but it should be about health and wellbeing, that that is our absolute priority for children in order to get to the place where we can address their learning. I do know that some schools have been great at using PEF money previously to work with around family learning, around parental engagement. It's probably one of the hardest things for them to do, they would say, I guess. But there are schools who do direct their PEF money to that purpose, and that's probably even more important now.
Echo that. An example, there are examples of PEF money being used to reduce, very directly, just reduce the cost of participation at school, school trips, activities, out-of-school clubs, ensuring that that money is used to make sure that there isn't a cost barrier or a financial barrier to participating in school life. That's important for health and well-being, just ensuring that children feel comfortable and part of the school day, as well as ensuring that they're able to fully participate in learning at school, as well as examples that Colin's mentioned of funding homeschool engagement support. So actually involving families, understanding families, identifying wider needs of families, to ensure that, again, by working with families, that those barriers to engagement at school are removed.
Is that what?
Yes, come in.
I would just echo what's been said by both Colin and by John. And I certainly, in terms of what the main issues are that I've spoken about earlier for the families that we directly support, anything that can be done around family mental health and well-being, generally, in collaboration with others in the community, and looking at those opportunities to support families to be able to re-engage locally, to be able to see what they can participate in and how, and support the sort of broader learning outcomes, I think would be a really valuable use of how we could look to see how we can use some of the pupil equity funding going forward. What we found in some of the areas where we work, where we have got services through pupil equity funding, is the importance of that consistent relationship. Someone who's there for the child and young person and family and can connect in with the school and other service has been critical during this period, because that's somebody who's remained in touch overall. So I think it is some of that broader non-siloed thinking about how we can come up with sort of like local community-based solutions with the school as part of that and PEF as part of that, aligning it with other support that's available. And in each area, that's going to look slightly different, and that's where that proactive engagement with the families is so critical. And I would, really welcome that being seen as a core and critical use of PEF, is to look to see how we can more meaningfully support and engage families.
Can you just briefly follow up on that?
Yeah, please.
Because I think that got to the nub of what I was trying to ask without leading the witnesses down that road. Schools don't exist in a silo. They are anchors within their community. They're already working with lots of third sector organisations. There's parent councils, there's pupil groups, there's a whole plethora of organisations around the school, and there's a real opportunity with PEF funding now guaranteed over a four-year period to do some key planning and consultation at a local level with the local community to decide how best to tackle poverty and enhance attainment in the wider role. And I think that's what SATWAT was effectively saying. I don't know if other witnesses want to come in and say that's how they would like to see it PEF used in the years going forward.
I think what you're saying, theoretically, yes, but it's more patchwork than pattern, I think is the expression I would use. That it's not the same everywhere. And you can have school clusters next door to each other who have very different approaches to this, who have very different levels of community engagement, of parental involvement, of a real commitment to learner voice and participation. These things are way too dependent on the leadership within a school or the culture within a school. These things are not embedded everywhere. And it's with UNCRC incorporation that this is one of the things that we need to smooth out, if you like, because it's unacceptable that as a child, that it's a bit of a lottery, that as a child or a family, I would have this particular experience with an early learning centre and a different experience if I go to one 5 miles down the road. So these are the things that we need to address systemically. It's not okay. It's a bit of a lottery at the moment. So there is no guarantee that a school receives PEF money and uses it in a way that you're describing. That, for me, okay, is something that we need to think about.
That's helpful. There was a contradiction between that local independence and flexibility and how we get consistency across local authorities and across Scotland. Mr Dickey, any final comments from you? And I won't come back in after that, Convener. That's my final question.
Sorry, getting consistency is not okay in terms of UNC or incorporation. The child's rights are the same if they live in Dunbar, North Berwick, Glasgow, the Western Isles. That we can't be doing with inconsistency anymore. It's not acceptable. The rights of the child mean that all of these things have to be consistent across the country, and there are means of redress when they're not. So I think it's fine to have something that we want to call local accountability or power within a local system. But in an overarching way, the system, the government, is responsible for delivering equity, and that's equity of experience.
Thank you, Colin, and thank you, Bob. Turn now to Ross.
Thank you, Kavira. I think John was looking to come in with final word.
Oh, sorry, John.
Two points to what was already said on PEF. I mean, one, just building on Colin's point, was the importance of actually talking to children, young people and parents as part of that process to identify what are the barriers that they're facing, what are the issues they're facing in terms of being able to engage at school and engage in learning more broadly, and using that as a starting point. And secondly, PEF isn't, that's one source of funding, but it needs to be is how that works alongside the other sources of funding that support family support in the community, third sector more generally, as well as the general funding segment at school. So all that money needs to work together to ensure that we're providing that, what everyone talks about, a holistic package of support to families.
Thank you for that, and apologies for cutting you off. I now turn to Ross.
Thanks, Convener. Before going on to my main line of questioning, I do just want to pick up on the point that Colin made there around UNCRC. Certainly, through the process of passing the bill and since passing the bill, everyone I've encountered across the public sector and politics, etc., we're all broadly talking the same language around UNCRC. But I'm concerned that there's an inconsistency in understanding about how this is actually going to change the practice of service providers or anyone else. You make a very valid point there around the difference between local flexibility and inconsistency in ensuring compliance with rights. Do you think that there is a broad and consistent understanding across Scotland about what UNCRC is actually going to mean for service providers and what changes to their practice it's going to mean?
No, I think there's a very poor understanding of that at the minute. And so it's a kind of a responsibility as people who worked hard for it all these years to make sure that people get the kind of support for that, whether it's professional knowledge or capacity building in a broader sense. So, for example, as an example, Children's Parliament currently has two bits of work, one funded by Young Start, which is called CP Investigates How Professionals Make Rights Real. And we're working with children and local professionals in Clackmannanshire and East Lothian to develop an approach, a resource, so that front-facing professionals understand what the convention means. So children and professionals are working together on that. We're working on another piece of work in Aberdeen and Edinburgh called Dignity in School, and we're working with primary schools so that they can build, they can become hubs for human rights practice. And so there'll be a resource that comes out of that people can use to support that journey, if I can use that word. So what we're trying to do is help front-facing professionals understand how this impacts on the work they do day to day, and to do that in a way that's kind of involves them and includes them, because it can be a wee bit scary, people thinking this is going to bring radical changes or this is another initiative. So what we need to help people to do is to kind of weave it through, to go with the things that they do intuitively that are already rights-based, but begin to name them as such, but also to kind of give them some support so that what we're talking about is progressive realisation. There's not a cliff edge. It will take a number of years to get this right. So we want to get alongside people to do it. So my answer is, I don't think front-facing professionals either really understand what it means. I don't think they're being given the support they need to understand what it means as yet. And it's not just about a kind of, you know, training introduction to UNCRC. It's much more about how they do their job, what being a duty bearer means to them. So we've got a lot of work to do, a lot of work.
Thanks very much. I think that's an issue that we'll probably want to return to. Going back to the Deputy Convener's line of questioning around positive interventions that were made over the last 18 months, when we had the Children's Commissioner in a couple of weeks ago, he made the point that in a perverse way, obviously given the overwhelmingly negative consequences of the pandemic, it did allow for some breakthrough, some positive developments. So, for example, with young people who were already disengaged with schools, in some cases, remote learning actually gave the school an opportunity to connect with those young people and their families in a way that they hadn't been able to do successfully before. So I'd be interested in your thoughts on whether there were any positive interventions, positive developments caused by the pandemic that were in danger of losing as we return to normal in whatever way that means. Are there any particular changes in practice that were clearly caused by the change of circumstances that was overwhelmingly out with our control, but that we should be looking to preserve because of the benefits they brought about, beyond the stuff that John in particular mentioned around additional funding, free school meals, etc.? But I'm interested in changes in practice in particular. Maybe start with John on that one.
I would hope that some of the things that we've learned from the pandemic are now being built into, so that recognition that devices, connectivity, support to ensure children are able to engage in remote learning, and not just remote learning, learning is part of the package of learning generally. Part of that is done at home using devices, even when we're not in lockdown situations. And that there is commitment now to ensure that every child has a device, has connectivity. What's absolutely critical now is that we ensure that government's held to account on that front, and that that actually happens in a way that ensures that's in place. The other thing that I'd already mentioned, I suppose, which was a kind of learning through the pandemic, was that importance of cash-based responses, and cash first is the most effective way of ensuring families have resources, generally speaking, is to ensure they have more money and then are able to make the choices about whether that's spent on paying the energy bills, paying for food, paying for school clothing and what have you. So I think there's things to learn. I think there's some positive things to learn. I think now it's about just making sure that we don't lose sight of those commitments that have been made over the last 2 years, and that they are really now just bedded into the system as mainstream approaches.
Thanks. Satwa, would you like to come in on this point?
Yep. It goes back to the fact that what we had to do through necessity was look to see how we could try different ways of ensuring that we were able to connect with, reach and engage people. And as you say, in some cases that worked really well for those who might have been disengaged or found it more difficult to make their way physically to school for a whole number of reasons. For others, it presented particular challenges. This is anecdotal, and I know you did receive some evidence, I think from Sally Cavers, was it last week? Which might have been around some of those children and young people who needed additional support for learning. Some found it very difficult to engage and be able to absorb what was happening in terms of online sessions and learning, and also the intensity of them. So I think something around how we can use hybrid methods of learning is one of the things that's a positive that could have come out of this. The greater understanding of home and family, which many institutions said that they now had as a result of being in people's homes in a way, digitally or whatever, seeing what those conditions were like. I do think digital access and recognising how critical and core that is as we go forward from this day on. But actually, thinking about it, we all experienced this pandemic differently there were lots of anxieties for many of us, but they were intensified for those families who had real financial concerns as a result of this and greater financial barriers. And I do think what's critical in terms of sort of like more broader learning going forward is how do we ensure regular and predictable income for families? And John's mentioned the Scottish Child Payment. I would say that's one of key mechanisms we need to be looking at to see how we can support those families on low incomes. And we would argue that the quicker that can be doubled, the better for families, you know, because it allows, it's one less stress to think about, and therefore it allows you to focus on other things. So I think just recognising the importance of that as the bedrock in terms of adequate, predictable, regular income is going to be critical to how we can go on to support children and young people to achieve some of the best, no, the best outcomes that they can, which is really what we're all about, sitting around at this committee. But I do think there is learning about what's worked well for some, what hasn't worked so well for others, and families will tell us that, and schools will be able to tell us some of that, and what Colin's spoken about for the work they're doing well. And how do we integrate hybrid ways of working and supporting young people going forward? So actually, if you find it really anxiety-inducing walking into school, how can we get you into that classroom virtually? We've shown that it's possible. It's now about making sure that we've got the tools, the connectivity, and most importantly, in some ways, over and above that, support. Support for the families. You know, we had technical hitches today. There was a team working on that to get us through that. The technical hitch happens at home. You need to be able to access someone for that support. So it is about equalising access in those ways, and there is a real opportunity here to look to see how we do that.
Thank you. Colin, do you have anything to add on this point?
I think a real learning for us has been that parents and carers have begun to value themselves as educators a bit more, which they are. They're the primary educator. But during lockdown, when a day was, not every day was good, I'm sure, but they began to realise that the play, the baking, the getting out on the bikes, these things are actually fundamental to a child's development. The problem with that is that these things, many of them also come with cost. So for a family struggling financially, what we saw was other third sector organisations working really hard to make sure the kids could get a bike, to make sure they had contents for baking. You know, so for families who had these means, these moments were really important, and I think we should continue to verbalise our acknowledgement as of parents and carers as educators, but also be involved with families so that we understand when they don't have these extra things now. So, you know, if your child is home economics in school, whatever, you know, if it's about bringing ingredients, which would be a kind of cost of the school day issue, but it's also just about being able to do these things at home. Is it possible for a child to do these things at home as part of their learning? So I think we've had an insight into family life as educators that we need to remember, not lose sight of.
Thanks very much. That's all from me, convener.
One more thing very quickly on that. I also think it's really important then to understand what the other priorities and pressures are on families and parents. Because actually whilst you may have been furloughed, you may have been working from home, that may no longer be the case. And there is something there around being able to work with what the family situation is. And it isn't one size fits all. So when we're looking at sort of hybrid models, it's recognising the other responsibilities and requirements that parents have, particularly single parents who don't have anyone else to share any of this with, and to make sure that we're not adding additional layers of pressure on families.
Thank you very much, and thank you, Ross. That actually brings us to the end of our evidence session this morning. I would especially like to thank John Dickey and Dr. Colin Morrison and Satwat Raymond for their evidence today, which has been very useful indeed, very insightful, in fact. I'd also like to mention that we were to be joined by Mark Crilly, who's the president of the National Union of Students Scotland, but for reasons completely beyond Mark's control, he wasn't able to actually join us for this meeting. although we have met him before and we look forward to meeting him again, but it would be it's absolutely appropriate that I put on the record that we give special congratulations to Matt because he graduated from the University of Strathclyde earlier this week. So well done, Matt. There you are. You're now in the official record of the Parliament with our congratulations. So the public part of today's meeting is now at an end. I will now suspend the meeting. Can I ask members to reconvene on Microsoft Teams, and this allows us to consider our final agenda items in private. Thank you and good morning.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye.